Come to the choir and let's sing. Take out your red book and go to page 46. Page 46. Page 71, then we'll have our ushers come and see her off. Page 71. Bottom of the page.
decision for you. They make that decision to not dispute each and every need. There is here today, children spoken and unspoken. Please just bless this offering that we can use it for the upbuilding of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Page 78.
I need the Savior's name.
Anybody got any special music tonight? If you do, come now.
I'll go do it.
I'm on my birthday. A family member.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay. Your sister told me to go back there, so.
Right. Good afternoon. If you have your Bibles with you tonight, let's stand. And we'll read the scripture tonight and share with you what the Lord has laid on our heart. Matthew chapter 14 tonight is where we'll be reading from. Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter 14. Very, very familiar scripture to us tonight and very familiar situation that the disciples had found themselves in. And you know, when you read this scripture and it's dealing with the disciples being in the ship, and the ship is being tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And we read that scripture and we see this physical storm and situation that the disciples are in, but we oftentimes look at that as being that it's their story, it's them in that situation, but oftentimes we find ourselves in, you've heard preachers say the storms of life or in different things, but we're going to preach on some thoughts here tonight that the Lord will help you with. So let's start reading in verses 22 out of Matthew 14. We'll read a few verses here, then we'll pray, and we'll possibly be in the book of Mark as well. And straightway, Jesus constrained his disciples to get into the ship and to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. When he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. Now, I want to stop there for a moment. For those of you that were here this morning, our sermon was on prayer. I had no idea that the Lord was going to tie these together, but notice the Lord Jesus is praying. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit," and they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer, Lord, tonight, giving you praise and thanks, God. And Lord, as we pray, God, for the needs of our church and those around us today in our community. Lord, we pray for those that are needing salvation in their hearts and lives. We're praying for those, God, that has needs, whether it be just a multitude of needs, physical, spiritual, whatever they are. God, we pray that through this scripture that's being preached on tonight, that it would help each and every one of us. Help us, God, to realize that when you are near to us, things are immediately better. Lord, we pray tonight for those that are unable to be here. We pray for those that are traveling. Pray for those that are sick. And God, we'll never forget to give you praise and honor and glory, for you're worthy of that praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, as we look in the scripture, just to put some background in with this, just right before Jesus constrained his disciples to get into the ship, He fed the 5,000 with the loaves and the two fishes. And the Bible also speaks of the 5,000 men besides women and children that were fed. Now, over in the book of John, you will find that in verse 14, it says, "Then those men, when they had seen the miracle that Jesus did, said, 'This is of a truth that prophet that should come into the world.' When Jesus therefore perceived that they would come and take him by force to make him a king, he departed again into a mountain himself alone." So this is John's account of the same place, the same situation of the disciples in that. And Jesus had sent the disciples to cross over before him. And the reason he did was he was departing that place. Now, he said he perceived that they would come and take him as a king. And you say, Pastor, Jesus was coming to be God's Lamb, the Savior, not a king. But he sent them away, and as he constrained them to get in the ship, they were to pass over. And during the passing over, the Bible speaks of it being the fourth watch of the night. Now, this fourth watch was always the darkest a part of night. Now, could you imagine? You know my story. I don't like darkness. I don't like being with the lights off. There has to be some type of light around, and that light brings comfort. So they're in the darkest part of night. The Bible describes the seas, the midst of the seas, of being tossed with waves, and the Bible says the wind was contrary. Now, contrary means they did not know which direction the wind was going to be blowing. If you've noticed in the last week or so, we've had many storms that have blown in our small little area, and when the wind blows, it just seems like it's always going in one direction. Now, how would you like to be in the storm to where the winds constantly change, the direction the flow comes at different angles, at different times? So in the midst of where they're at, and by the way, this sea is known for such sudden storms to pop up right out of nowhere. And you know what? Life, it hits us like that sometimes. Things just pop up right out of nowhere. Now remember, most of the disciples, they were fishermen. They were experienced men, experienced within the sea. And they knew how to take care of things. But I want to show you something tonight. It's found over in the book of Mark. And notice the Bible's, Mark's description of the same event that had taken place. And the Bible says, "When even was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, he alone on the land, and he saw them toiling in rowing." Now, you say, Pastor, what does that mean? That means that they were extremely working hard. They were putting every ounce, every moment of energy that they had just to keep the ship afloat. I was thinking about this. You know, there's times in our lives that we've been so busy. We've put so much effort, whether it be yard work or some type of physical labor, where you get to the point where you're absolutely exhausted and you feel like that you can't even stand up. You have no strength about you. I see the disciples rowing and struggling and working as hard as they can. And no matter how much they row, no matter how much they're pulling, no matter how much energy they're putting in and that, they feel like they're getting nowhere. Ever been like that? I sure have been. But notice this, in Mark's reading in that, the Bible says he alone on land and saw them toiling and rowing. Jesus knew exactly where they were. Just like he does you and I tonight. He knows our situation. He knows our surroundings. He knows the needs. He knows our struggles. He knows everything about us. Now notice this, the Bible describes the Bible says in verse 26 out of Matthew, when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled. Now this troubled is not a physical trouble. Remember, they're toiling, they're rowing, they're physically exhausted, but now they are troubled. I attribute this trouble a spiritual trouble, amen. Spiritually, they see something that is disturbing. You know, sometimes we see things that are disturbing and they trouble us. Now notice this, saying it is a spirit, and they cried out for fear. Now notice this, they cried out for fear, but Jesus already knew what was going on. But notice this, the Bible says straightway. There's no delay in this. There was no pause in this. As soon as they cried out, notice Jesus speaks to them. He said, "Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid." Now remember, as they're in the storm, tossed up and down, and just going any direction, the wind's coming at him from wherever it comes, and they're seeing what they think is a spirit. It's troubled them. They're exhausted. And immediately when they cry out, they hear the voice of Jesus. You say, "Pastor, what did that do?" It done two things. It brought them hope, and it brought them comfort. Because listen, they had seen and experienced the miracles that Jesus had done. You know what? Many of us in here tonight, we have seen the miracle working hands of God. We've seen Jesus show up and instantly bring us peace and comfort and joy. What about those times when we're at the doctor and we're worried about a test they're going to run, or we're worried about the result? Hey, listen, let me say this tonight. Just talk to Jesus, amen, because every time he talks to me, it's peace, it's comfort. Hey, listen, when Jesus speaks, there's hope. Now, what I'm getting at is this. When they realized Jesus was nearby, they knew that everything was going to be all right. Notice this. The Bible says, "And Peter answered him, said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water." Now listen, now notice this. Say, "Pastor, why would Peter get out of a boat that's kept him alive this long?" Listen, because he wanted to get to where Jesus is at. You know why we come to church? To get closer to Jesus. You know why we pray like we do in our sermon this morning? We pray to get closer to Jesus. You know why we read our Bibles? Because we're getting closer unto Jesus. Now, I know the story. I know Peter walked on water. I know he took his eyes off of Jesus. And I know he began to sink. But you know who rescued him? The only one that could. Hey, listen, I've got assurance tonight that when I take my eyes off of Jesus, you know what? He's going to rescue me when I cry out. You know the best part about this scripture, about 20 something years ago when I started preaching, I've missed this for many years. You know what? The Bible talks about him coming back to the boat. Picture this. Here's Jesus. Here's Peter. He's sinking, and Jesus grabs a hold love him. This is my vision. You say, Pastor, how'd they get in the boat? Jesus carried them there. Hey, listen, wherever Jesus is at, there's hope, there's peace, and there's comfort. And for a lost person, there is salvation, forgiveness of sins. Notice this next part found over in Mark. The Bible says in this, for the wind was contrary unto them. About the fourth watch of the night, he cometh unto them. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm glad that no matter where I'm at, you know what? We had that winter storm just a few months ago, one of the worst ones we've had in a long time. The roads closed down. They said if you're if you've got an emergency situation, don't call 911 because they can't get to you. You know what? That makes it scary sometimes. But Jesus can come where you're at. Amen. Think about this. And the Bible says. And it says, walking up on the sea. Now listen, I want you to think about this. You say, Pastor, why was he up on the sea? He was above the storm. He was above those waves. He was in a place that he could be seen. And you say, Preacher, where's that place today? High and lifted up. And it says, and when they saw him walking upon the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit and cried out, for they all saw him and were troubled, and immediately he talked with them. Hey, listen, I don't know about you. I've had some good talks in my life, good talks with my mom and dad, good talks with my wife, good talks with my family, good talks with my friends, good conversations with my church, but nobody has ever talked to me like Jesus. Amen. Hey, listen, I'm talking about a talk that's helpful, a talk that gives us direction, a talk that gives us hope, and a talk that gives us comfort. You know, the first conversation I had is when I asked him to save me and be the Lord of my life and to forgive me of my sins. And you know what? By the way, that's the best night of sleep I've ever got in my life. Think about this. No matter the trouble, no matter the situation, no matter what's going on, he's always got his eye on us. You know, I can remember our kids when they were little and growing up. What did we do as parents? We always tried our best to have an eye on our kids because we knew if we could see them, we could protect them. If we could see them, we could take care of them. If we could see them, we could try our best to prevent them from falling. And you know what? We tried our best. Hey, sometimes things happen. But you know what I learned? As they got older and got in school, guess what? Mom and daddy can't be there anymore. You say, Pastor, what happened then? That's when faith kicked in. Because guess what? The Lord is watching over them. Caleb was just, he was five, maybe fixing to turn 6 years old. And this was kindergarten, all right, over at Mary Blount Elementary. And Laurie and Caleb went in there. And you know what? It was more of a scary time for Mama than it was Caleb, all right? She cried like a baby. And they got there. And you know what? Caleb said, Mama, it'll be all right because God's here. And you know what that done for me, for a five-year-old to say, you know what? God's got this. Hey, listen, Jesus has got this tonight. Brother Mike, you come get us a song. The Bible says he saw them toiling in rowing. They're struggling. Struggling. He sees us tonight. Most importantly, he's the one that can help. The Bible says in verse 51, and when he went unto them into the ship, and the wind ceased, and they were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure and wondered. I like having Jesus on board, I'll be honest with you. Let's stand tonight as we sing.
Page 65, bottom of the page. I was walking up the stairs and heard Tammy mention that, and I said, there ain't no way but God can do that. You know, I'm glad God puts things together, you know. I'm not good at stuff, okay. Most of the time when, you know the old saying, measure twice and cut once. We measured 5 or 6 times and recut it 3 or 4 times. I tried putting crown molding up one time, okay. You talk about the awfulest mess you've ever seen in your life. I wasted 2 probably 16-foot pieces of crown molding before I could ever get something close enough to where I could put caulk on it, all right? That's how bad it was. But God, he can take just things and put it together and arrange it the way he sees fit. So don't forget our announcements, prayer requests, praying one for another. Jerry Goins, you dismiss us in prayer, please.
Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this message tonight, dear God. Please, dear God, be with all of us and give us more faith, dear God. And help us to be focused upon you, dear God. Concentrate more about heavenly things instead of earthly things. I pray, dear God, that you forgive us when we fail to do what we should as Christians. Lord, we love you and we're thankful for what you've done for us. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.